contagious. Bring a summer glory to our God. Come, let's bow, kneel before our Maker. Praise Him now, there is no one greater. Bring a summer glory to our God. You made the earth, the oceans wide, the desert plains, the mountains.
And welcome to worship with Southport Salvation Army. Although we can't see you, although we can't shake your hand or even give you a hug, we are glad that you've joined us, and we hope that our time together will bring new meaning into our lives today. If you're joining us for the first time, you are particularly welcome. If you're watching on YouTube, why not click on subscribe to subscribe to our channel and click on the bell to be informed when we upload new content. And if you'd like to, either on YouTube or Facebook, why don't you leave us a comment telling us where you're joining us from and how our virtual meetings might be helping you, or any other comment. We'd love to hear from you. Did you catch the words of the song that we just played? Come, let us sing to the Rock of Ages. Worship Him, joyful and contagious. The good news of the love of God is going viral. And right now, it's being shared across the country in word and in deed. Let's not be shy in spreading the virus of love. We have lots to share this morning and we'll be hearing from a number of people from our church family. Later on, Michael will be bringing us a message and he'll be explaining what Thomas the Disciple and Victor Meldrew have in common. His message will be the first of a two-part series entitled The Doubter and the Denier. We opened up our meeting on a note of praise with words based on Psalm 95, which says, "Come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before him with thanksgiving and extol him with music and song." And now we are going to continue on that note of praise and thanksgiving as we sing a song inspired by Psalm 103, in which we remind ourselves to wake up, get on our feet and praise God for his goodness to us. Let's sing together, "Praise My Soul, the King of Heaven."
Our reading this morning is taken from John and chapter 20 and verses 19 to 23. And this takes place on Easter Sunday morning. The tomb is empty and Jesus has already appeared to Mary Magdalene. And we pick up the story later the same day. On the evening of the first day of the week, when the disciples were together with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side, and the disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, their sins are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they're not forgiven."
Listen to the words of the risen Christ. And the wound in his side. Peace be with you. With the eyes of faith, are you ready to see? Peace be with you. Listen to the words of the risen Christ. Peace be with you. Come and see his hands and the wound in his side. Peace be with you. With the eyes of faith.
Shall we pray? Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day where we can gather together. We thank you for the technology that makes it possible. We praise you, Lord, even though we may find ourselves in tough situations or hard places, that you are the rock of our salvation. You are the Lord of all, and we can trust you with our lives. Lord, we remember those who are a part of our church family, but for various reasons cannot join with us. We pray that you will draw close to them this morning, that they too will know your love and presence with them. We thank you for the peace that you offer to each one of us, and I pray that we will be comforted by this peace and that our hearts will be drawn to yours. We pray for our nation at this time, for our leaders who face difficulty, who face tough decisions on a daily basis. We thank you for our wonderful NHS and for the staff who put the needs of their patients before their own welfare, and for the part that we can play, simply by staying at home and keeping each other safe. As we spend this time together today, may we be encouraged, challenged and changed. May we sense that we are a community, even if we are scattered at this time. And may your word dwell in each of us richly, such that we are better equipped to live well this week. I pray this in your name. Amen.
Joining us on this lovely Sunday morning. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Janine Davis. The Salvation Army here in Southport has been my home and my church for over 30 years. I come from a Salvation Army background, and I'm very fortunate to have a number of my family here with me in Southport Salvation Army. Thank you for joining us, as I've said. Today we have an opportunity to talk to the lovely Tom Holsworth. So let's hear what he has to say. Tom, could you tell us a little bit about yourself?
Yeah, so obviously I'm Tom, 25 yesterday. Well, it's not yesterday, it'll be last week by the time you guys see this video. I started coming along to Salvation Army events when I was about 9 or 10 years old. To events like Kids Club, Shocking, which is Say More or something like that now. It used to be called Shocking back when we were hip and trendy. Yeah. And all sorts of other youth events. And then I started coming along to the Alpha, and it was one brunch church that I actually came along to a worship at the Salvation Army. And as they say, the rest is history. I've been to almost every Sunday, work allowing as it is, since that Sunday morning. I'm the only member of my family who goes to the Salvation Army. I'm not the only Christian in my family. We all worship in different ways though. And I'm currently a second year student nurse at Edgehill doing adult
Lovely.
Nursing.
So you say that you're a nurse, an extremely challenging job, as we know, especially at this particular time. So can you talk to us about, a little bit about that, the position you're in at the moment currently as a nurse?
Yeah, so at the moment, I suppose I'm fortunate in one sense that I'm one of the few groups of people that actually gets to get out of the house, so I get to avoid the cabin fever. But I suppose on the other end of things, I am in one of the groups that is very heavily exposed to this coronavirus that we're facing at the moment. As a student at the moment, most placements have been cancelled, but they're planning to mobilise students, so we've been given an option to opt in or opt out. And if we opt in, we'll be working as students, but in a slightly different way. So currently as a student, I wouldn't count towards numbers on a ward. I'd be a supernumerary, and I'd be able to get in and learn things, and there wouldn't really be expectations of me to fulfil the workload on the ward. But if I opt in, I'll be a paid member of staff, where I'll be expected to get hands in, do the things I can as a healthcare assistant, but also those extra bits that I can do as a student nurse. But on top of that, I'll also be expected to try and learn in amongst all of that, as well as supporting everyone. So at the moment, I'm just working on what we call the bank. So I'm a bank healthcare assistant. And I've been actually working in a palliative care ward for the corona patients, supporting those sufferers who are unfortunately not going to win their battle with a coronavirus. So that's been a bit challenging as well.
Right. So given what you've just told us, can you tell us about some of the challenges and also the joys you have experienced living out your Christian faith over the past weeks?
Mm-hmm. So first off, I think if I didn't have a Christian faith, I really don't know how I'd be processing all this at the moment. I really don't think I'd be able to cope, as it were. And it can be a little bit difficult being a Christian in these sorts of environments, because as a nurse, we've got to be aware of our own religious beliefs and spiritual beliefs and political beliefs. And we've got to be like infinitely careful that we're not imposing our beliefs on other people, because, you know, we're seen as figures of authority to a degree, and you know, people expect us to lead them in certain circumstances. So we've got to be very careful about how we do show our beliefs. So I think one important thing for me is living my life the way that we're instructed to, you know, trying to be a good Christian, as it were, and lead by that example. And then if people do question, then that's your opportunity to open that door. But working on the palliative ward, one really important part of patient care is looking after the spiritual needs, because yes, it's all good and well that they're fit and healthy, but sometimes where you are in your head, where you are psychologically, makes a big difference to your recovery. And if you're in a place of good spirit, as it were, it really does help you help your recovery. So for anyone who's been to hospital, you know, one of the first questions on the forms are, do you have any spiritual beliefs, do you belong to a religion? And a handful of my patients have, so it's meant that actually it isn't inappropriate for me to say to them, oh well, also I have a religion, might not be the same religion as theirs. Or there's been a few patients that I actually have come into contact with that I know from the Salvation Army that I've seen in our own citadel, and that's been a nice link for them. It's been a comforting link for me to say, hang on a second, do I recognize you, do you go here, do you go there? And they've gone, actually, yeah, now you say it, it's been a bit of a comfort for some of those patients to know there's someone who sort of understands. But on top of that, I can think back to, I've been doing a lot of nights at the moment, and nights tend to be the worst time. It's when people sort of slow down and relax, and a lot more people do tend to decline in the night. And we had a patient admitted to the ward who was a Catholic, so a priest came out to see him and give him last rites. And at the same time, there was another patient who unfortunately had been promoted to glory, and came to do prayers to the dead for him, as was his belief as a Catholic also. So it actually meant that I could go with the priest, and I prayed alongside and prayed with those people, so I was able to offer spiritual support for them in that time. You know, they say when two or more are gathered in my name, then I'll be there. So it meant that I could stand there with the priest and be another sounding board for God for them.
Lovely, Tom, and thank you for giving us some insight as to where you are exactly right now. I'd like to pray with you, Tom. Is there anything in particular that you would like me to pray for?
Yeah, so for me, a big thing I'd like to pray for is the family members of the patients that I've been dealing with at the moment who can't come in and be alongside their loved ones as they're passing. On top of that, the students who are taking up the call to go out into the hospitals and deal with these challenges, maybe not having as much exposure to such difficult things so far.
Okay, should we take a moment to pray now then? Let us pray. Dear Lord, let me firstly thank you for Tom, for his passion and his commitment, Lord, and his love for his vocation working as a nurse in these really difficult times. Dear Lord, as Tom mentioned, we pray for those who have volunteered for those positions in the NHS. Be with them, Lord, too. Help us to remember that even in the darkest moments that you are there, and your love gives us hope. We pray for all of the families, like Tom has said, who have lost loved ones, and those who have seriously ill family members and are unable to visit, unable to hold their hand, Lord, just now. Unable to reassure them, it is so difficult. Lord, take away their fear, take away the anxiety, and protect all of those suffering in whatever way just now. Be with those people making decisions, the decisions that affect lives and families, not only here, but in other countries around the world. Dear Lord, we ask all of these things in and through your name, Lord. Amen.
Somebody's praying for me.
for our second reading this morning, we're reading John chapter 20 and verses 24 to 31. Now Thomas, also known as Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail prints in his hands, and put my finger where the nails were, and put my hands into his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here. See my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." Then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. And blessed are those who have not seen and yet believed." Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book, but these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. Amen.
Hi everybody, welcome to the second edition of Kids Aloud and Kids Church online. We hope you've had a really good Easter break and you are back now to some normality of getting your schoolwork done and having your day-to-day routine, albeit very, very different still. So today I want to talk to you about thinking about things that we are asked to believe, but we can't necessarily see. So at this moment in time, we're all being asked to alter our way of life, the way we live, the way we're existing and what we're doing, because of a virus. And that we can't see that virus, but we can see the effects of it. We're seeing on the news that people are being very poorly with it, and sadly some people are even dying from it. And as a result of that, we're being asked to stay at home and not mix with other people, and to wash our hands and be really, really careful about our hygiene and cleaning things so that we can get rid of this virus and stop us succumbing to it. So we can't actually see that virus because it's so, so tiny, but we are having to believe that it's real. And sometimes it's really, really difficult to believe in something that you haven't seen for yourself. And that's something that we're asked to do as Christians. You know, we haven't seen Jesus. He was born over 2,000 years ago, and he died and came back to life again over 2,000 years ago. But we today actually have not physically seen him. Yet there are millions of Christians all over the world who believe in Jesus and believe that he is real, and that what he does for us and the effect that he has in our lives is very, very real. And so we are asked as a body of people to actually believe in something that we cannot see. And today I want to tell you about somebody in the Bible who didn't believe that Jesus was alive again. So we know that Jesus, on Good Friday, he was put to death on the cross, and then on Easter Sunday, he rose again. And there were people who went to the tomb. So Mary and some of the disciples went to the tomb, and they found that the tomb was empty, Jesus' body was no longer there, and the cloth was folded neatly and left in the tomb. And then we had a story about Jesus appearing to some of the disciples who were walking on the Emmaus Road. And they didn't recognize that it was Jesus that came and joined them on that road until he came and broke the bread. Remember, we had the story where the little dolls walked along the path, and that Jesus came and joined them and walked along with them. So they believed when they'd seen Jesus appear to them. Now, there was another of the disciples called Thomas. So this is the story of Thomas, and that Thomas didn't believe that Jesus was still alive. And he's known as Doubting Thomas. And this is from a book in the Bible called John. It's one of the Gospels. So Thomas wasn't in the room when Jesus came, and he didn't see him personally. He did not believe what his friends had told him about witnessing Jesus, and promised that he wouldn't believe until he saw Jesus face to face. When Jesus did show up later and showed his wounds, Thomas must have felt really embarrassed. But the amazing thing is that Jesus said, "Blessed are those who have not seen and yet still believe." He commended people who believed in him without witnessing face to face. Do you know who that is? That's us. We haven't physically seen Jesus, but we still believe in him. And so this is the actual excerpt from John 20, verses 19 to 21. And I'm just going to read it directly from the Bible. Okay. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together, with the doors locked for fear of Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them, and he said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, their sins are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." Now, Thomas, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands and his feet, and put my finger where the nails were, and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." A week later, the disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them that time. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here in my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord, my God." And then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen me and yet have believed." Jesus performed many other signs of his presence to his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. Amen.
I want to talk this morning about doubt. And I want to do that for two reasons. I want to talk about doubt first, because within the church, the resurrection is still very much at the forefront of our minds. And I'm well aware that not everyone was convinced about the resurrection then, and not everyone's convinced about the resurrection now. Second, I want to talk about doubt because it's often at times of crisis that we find ourselves asking what and whether we really believe. Times just like this. Right now, as we're going through this turbulent time, there are Christians who are holding confidently to their belief and conviction that God is right here, right now, in the middle of this coronavirus. Right now, there are not yet Christians, agnostics perhaps, who are wavering on the point of belief, and they're searching frantically for evidence that God is right here, right now. And right now, there are atheists who don't profess any faith, but with so much of life stripped away, they're perhaps beginning to ask some of those big questions like, is there a God? Does he really care? Does faith in God actually make any difference in the real world? And we're going to look at doubt, and we're going to look at faith, and we're going to do it through the story of Thomas in John chapter 20 in the New Testament. And I want to start by saying that actually I feel just a little bit sorry for poor old Thomas, because never again will he be known just as Thomas. He will be forever Doubting Thomas. He will be known forever and because of one moment in time, as a man who doubted, a man who lacked faith, a man who lacked belief. Imagine being referred to forever as Doubting Thomas. It's possibly on a par with hearing cries of, "I do not believe it," for the rest of your life. Such is the unfortunate destiny of the actor Richard Wilson, who played the unfortunate Victor Meldrew in the series One Foot in the Grave. Imagine your label practically becoming a trademark to the extent that people are named after you. Oh, you're such a Doubting Thomas. Imagine being labelled as an impatient Patrick, an unkind Kevin, an unbelieving Betty, or even an angry Arthur. Imagine being the inspiration behind that kind of label, based on one brief moment in your life. I want to suggest that when we reduce Thomas to such a negative, stereotypical label, we actually do two things. Firstly, we do Thomas an injustice. Secondly, we do doubt an injustice. It's as if we only see half the picture. Let me give you an example. Here's a sign that was pictured on a wall a few years back. Let's read it. "There's no way in the world you'd take a young homeless person in for the night, because let's face it, anything might happen. You could be robbed, beaten up, or even worse. The thought of it makes you shiver. They're having a tough time, but it's really not your problem." Now let's stand back and read it again from a slightly different angle. Things suddenly look very different, don't they? "There's no way in the world you'd turn someone in need away. Take a young homeless person, for example. You could bring them in for the night, because let's face it, out on the street, absolutely anything might happen. You could be helping to stop someone being robbed, beaten up, or worse, abused. It's cold and lonely out there. The thought of it makes you shiver. Young people need a helping hand. They're having a tough time, but a safe, secure place would help. It's really not your problem, but you could still make a difference." So, before we label Thomas as Doubting Thomas and write him off completely, perhaps we should just stop and take another look at the question of doubt. Now, if I'm really honest, I think that if I'd been in Thomas's shoes, I would have reacted in exactly the same way. I mean, having witnessed Jesus die on a cross, I think that I would have needed just a bit more than the word of a group of grief-stricken friends whose collective imagination was probably playing tricks on them. If I was going to move from doubt to belief, I would have to see the evidence of Jesus' resurrection for myself. It was actually completely rational for Thomas to wait before he reached his own conclusion and believed. As a matter of intellectual belief, Thomas's doubting makes perfect sense. But actually, there's another way of looking at this story. In his book Closer Still, Scott Evans, the author, writes about Thomas, and he says this: "Poor Doubting Thomas. Why didn't he believe? Why couldn't he muster enough faith to proclaim that Jesus had risen? Perhaps because belief is not the central issue of Thomas's story. Perhaps it's because whether or not Thomas believed in Jesus was not as important as how much he loved him. Put yourself in Thomas's shoes. Someone you've loved and lived for and learnt from for such a long time has been killed. You've believed the miracles, you've seen the signs and the wonders, but now it's over and you're utterly distraught. Then someone comes along and tells you a few days later that he's alive, and you're hardly likely to believe them. Because when Jesus' light was extinguished, so was yours." Scott Evans goes on to say this: "Thomas's response is beautiful because it denies truth in favour of love for the sake of the heart. Watching Jesus die was the most painful thing he'd ever experienced. His world changed when Jesus died. It ended. And Thomas just is not prepared to hope again, to love again, to live again, unless he knows it is real." Thomas did not have too little faith to believe. He had too much love for belief to be taken lightly. And so perhaps the question for us today is not, have you answered enough questions about Jesus to believe he's alive? Perhaps instead, the question we need to be asking is, have you, have I, have we experienced enough of Jesus to fall in love with who he is? Is your life becoming intertwined with his? You know what? Perhaps we have more in common with Thomas than we first thought. His doubt wasn't a sign that he was a failure. It was a clear sign that he was a human. But doubt isn't just a sign of humanity. It's also a signpost to the mystery of God. If Jesus had wanted to remove all doubt about his return, I think he could have been a little bit more obvious and a little bit more, less private. If he'd wanted Thomas to believe right away, I'm sure he could easily have found a way to convince him beyond all doubt. But God doesn't always work like that. He doesn't reveal himself in ways that remove all doubt and offer convincing proof. Because if he did, there'd be nobody watching this today who was still wrestling with questions about life and death. I think there's always an element of mystery about faith. And perhaps that's why we read these words in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1. Now, faith is confidence in what we hope for and assurance about what we do not see. God doesn't impose belief. Instead, he gives hints and clues to the fact of his existence and of his love. He leaves us enough room to explore who he is, to think things through, to ask ourselves whether we can trust Jesus with our heads and with our hearts. Listen to these two quotes for a moment. Philip Yancey, the writer, said that inquisitiveness and questioning are inevitable parts of the life of faith. Where there's certainty, there's no room for faith. Meanwhile, the philosopher René Descartes once said, "If you would be a real seeker after truth, it is necessary that at least once in your life you doubt, as far as possible, all things." Kind of comforting and encouraging, I think. We'll always live life accompanied by an element of doubt and questioning and mystery. Job chapter 11, verse 7 in the Old Testament asks the question, "Can you fathom the mysteries of God? Can you probe the limits of the Almighty?" And in case you're still wondering, the answer is no. I remember hearing the principal of my Bible college talking about the day on which he received his doctorate, his PhD. This is what he said. "I never felt so thick as on the day I became Dr. Steve Brady." Because Dr. Steve Brady realised on that day that the mysteries of God are endless and eternal. There is always more to know and always more to understand about God. But doubt isn't just a sign of humanity. It isn't just at the heart of mystery. For Thomas, doubt was also a doorway to discovery. Let's turn to John chapter 20 again. A week later, his disciples were in the house again and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here, see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Stop doubting and believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." Maybe worshipping Thomas would be a more fitting label. We will never fathom the mysteries of God. There will always be unanswered questions. There will always be uncertainties. There will be times when we wish that God would just be a bit more obvious. But there will still come a point when you know it in your head and you know it in your heart that Jesus Christ is Lord. There will come a point when you can answer for yourself questions like this. Did Jesus really rise from the dead? Is God still at work in the world? And if so, what difference does that fact make to my life? Right here, right now, in the middle of the lockdown and the coronavirus. Paul Tillich once said that doubt isn't the opposite of faith. It's an element of faith. Or if you like, they're two sides of the same coin. And it might just be that for somebody who's watching today, doubt is about to become an important doorway to discovery of faith in Jesus Christ. Before I end, I just want to say one more thing, and I think it's really important that we say it at this moment. Doubt is also a doorway to something else, and that something else is a deeper sense of community. Let me read to you from a book called We Make the Road by Walking, written by Brian McLaren. He's talking as if he was one of the disciples who was present on the night when Thomas finally met the risen Jesus. And this is what he says. If Jesus had wanted to start an uprising when he rose from the dead, well, we learned something that night about what this uprising was going to be about. It isn't for brave people, but for scared folk like us who are willing to become brave. It isn't just for believers, but also for doubting folk like Thomas who want to believe in spite of their skepticism. It isn't just for good people, but for normal, flawed people like you and me and Thomas. We have a term for what we experienced that night, and that term is fellowship. Fellowship is a kind of belonging that isn't based on status or achievement or gender, but instead it's based on a deep belief that everyone matters, everyone is welcome, everyone is loved, no conditions, no exceptions. So fellowship is for scarred people and scared people. It's for people who want to believe but aren't sure what or how to believe. When we come together just as we are, we begin to rise again, to believe again, to hope again, to live again. The world today is full of scared people and scarred people. The world today is full of doubters, and as we'll see next week, it's also full of deniers. It's full of believers and it's full of skeptics. It's full of normal, flawed folk like you and me and like Thomas. The truth is this, we're all in this together. At times we find ourselves walking through the valley of the shadow of death. But at other times we find ourselves walking through the valley of the shadow of doubt. And through it all, Jesus invites us to love him and believe in him with our hearts as well as our heads. Through it all, he invites us to enter into the daily mystery of experiencing more of him. Through it all, he invites us to a deeper sense of fellowship with each other as we journey together towards faith, greater faith, in these massively uncertain times. And so I want to say to you today, whether you are young or old, convinced or certain, or maybe not at all certain, whatever doubts you have right now, embrace those doubts. And as you do so, may you find faith. May you find Jesus. May you begin to rise again, to believe again, to hope again, to live again. May God bless you. In a moment, we're going to listen to a wonderful song sung by Cara, and it includes the following words. We pray for wisdom, your voice to hear. We cry in anger when we cannot feel you near. We doubt your goodness. We doubt your love, as if every promise from your word is not enough. And all the while, you hear each desperate plea and long that we'd have faith to believe. As Cara sings, I want to invite you to take a step of faith and put your trust in the risen Jesus. I want to invite you to fall more in love with Jesus. I want to invite you to embrace the mystery of his grace and his presence. I want to invite you to push open the door to discover his love. And I want to invite you to join with countless others as we join together on the same journey in seeking Christ. And in finding him, may you be blessed. Thank you. Let's pray. Loving Heavenly Father, we thank you that as we look at the world around us, we see evidence of you. We see your fingerprints in the beauty of creation. We sense your goodness in the countless men and women who are serving selflessly for our country at this time. We recognize your mercies in disguise in the midst of these trying times. And we thank you. I want to pray this morning. Will you touch our hearts with your love, expressed in a thousand different ways? Will you help us to realise that although we may not see you in person, we can have confidence in what is not seen, because the evidence for you is all around us. In our humanity, may you help us to love you more. in your great mystery, may you help us to search for you more. And as we do, may you open the door so that we may find you, believe, and be blessed. I pray this in your name. Amen. Well, it's been wonderful to share with you again today. We hope that as you've joined with us in worship, wherever you are, however you've watched, we pray that you will have been encouraged, uplifted, and energized for the week that comes ahead. We heard earlier from our virtual choir, and now to end our service, our virtual band is going to play a lively piece of music entitled Walking in the Light. So all that remains for me to say is thank you for joining us. Goodbye. God bless you. And God willing, we'll see you the next time. Thank you.